Hello everyone, and welcome to this mini-lecture on the historical background of popular culture in the U.S. So when we look at the rise of popular culture in the U.S., there's a couple major things that helped influence it and develop it over the last 200 years. The first is actually the creation of the printing press. The printing press is created in the 1400s, but it really becomes a behemoth in as publishing of printing material in the 1500s, that is the 16th century. And this really is what we consider the start of popular culture, or the start of the products of popular culture, because it's with the printing press we can mass produce the written word, and we can really mass produce it. From there, we see this historical trend of being able to mass produce lots of different things, and that's a lot of what we look at when we look at popular culture, is this mass produced product, concept, what have you, that is then accessed, consumed, interacted with by many people, right? That's the popular part. The culture is the actual product or thing being engaged with. But we really see the start of popular culture in the 18th and 19th century. Some would say 18th with the rise of even chapbooks, such as Mary Robinson's The Narrative Captivity of Mrs. Mary Robinson. But you really start to see it in the 19th century, and as we see in the first chapter within the book that we're reading by Jim Cullen, we really see it with the newspapers and the mass production of the written word accessible, that penny press, right? Things so cheap that everybody or nearly everybody can afford it. And we also see that as a result of, you know, the positioning of urbanization, industrialization, and democratization. Those three things come hand in hand with this development. That is, the urbanization allows for things to spread quickly because people live in such close quarters and such close relation to one another. Industrialization is both a byproduct and a contributor to urbanization. You have large masses of people, they're working in large, large buildings, unlike ever before. We see this, we certainly see this today, right? You go into Boston and there are ginormous buildings filled with hundreds, if not thousands, of people going there to work. Some, in modern day, they go in for different jobs, for different businesses and the like, but we did see these very large industrial centers build up in the 1800s, and that went hand in hand with urbanization, people coming in and working machines throughout the day to produce things. In democratization, this also connects to urbanization in that the masses of people have or are part of what we consider, this democratic republic, the United States, and there is this expectation of their rights and the recognition of equality. Now, equality is a loaded term. We still haven't achieved perfect equality in the ways in which I think our forefathers were hoping for. But we do see this leveled playing field that comes with urbanization and industrialization of many people making income, having disposable income. Now, disposable income doesn't mean we're buying yachts. It means we have some money left over at the end of the week for entertainment. And a lot of popular culture is actually about democratization of that which many people privilege is that which made even more available, right? So if we think about televisions, if we think about cell phones, as those became popular, they also became cheaper, right? How cheap are cell phones today considering all the things that you can do with them and what they were when they first came out? So these kind of things coalesce in the 19th century that really allow for the rise of popular culture. It allows for things to spread faster among larger groups of people and the quicker production of those items. And so that gives us, as I said, mass production and mass culture. Lots of people together, and these ideas will spread quickly among them. And really that idea of people are looking to participate. Once you move into the urban setting, once we see more urban and suburban environments, we have people that they have their work day, but then they also have this time in which they're not working. Unlike in a farm, or unlike in rural areas where you have to be working almost from sunup to sundown, at least in the early 1800s, and even really today, you have this dynamic of free time, and free time surrounded by lots of other people. So there's an encouragement to do more things. Go to dance halls, go to sporting events, read, go to movies, those kind of things. Well, not in the 1800s, they didn't have movies yet. And one of the things that we see happening within the 1800s is the de-establishing of the old model of elite and peasant. This happens for a couple reasons. I think in the U.S. It happens because there's not as strong of an aristocracy. There is a higher class, certainly. There is an elite class in the U.S. I think that would be hard to argue otherwise. But they don't necessarily maintain the same rights and the same dynamic that we see with nobility in Europe. But we do see some of this de-established in kind of the rise of, you know, a democratization of information, knowledge, and interest. The elites will always continue to try to control the masses, that is the non-elites, the people that are not as rich or as powerful, and there's certain truth to that all the way up through today if we look at if we look at politics in the United States and how much money is generated or contributed to by the elites in order to influence politics and the like. So this de-establishment, what we had seen historically in culture is we have elite culture and we have folk culture. And elite culture was, you can think of the works of Michelangelo. You can think of those high prestige works. And folk culture was just kind of what the common people were doing. But what the common people were doing were isolated. They weren't mass produced. They were produced by individuals or by small groups. And we still have this today. There's this romanticization of folk culture, of things made by individuals, by things made by, you know, a person and not a machine. I would say there's a certain amount of romancing of that idea in today's culture, depending on how people approach it. So what we tend to think of folk culture is that it's quaint, it's unique, it's innocent, whereas elite culture is proper tradition and of high quality. So what we have here is these two were the traditional dynamics of culture, the folk culture and the elite culture. But mass culture challenges all of that, because what happens when you can reproduce the Mona Lisa 50,000 times, and so everybody can have a copy of the Mona Lisa, right? What happens when you can produce products, be it weapons, be it toys, that are all the same but are all of better quality than what you might see in folk culture, because folk culture, you're relying on an individual skill, and yes, that individual may be skillful, but they're still, you know, it may break, and then to replace it might be challenging. So there's a lot of interesting challenges that mass culture offers up. You know, you can pay $20 for a book by this literary author, or you could pay 5 cents and get twice the amount of reading. So there's these trade-offs that are going on, and of course elite culture is threatened by mass culture because many people are interested in it, invested in it, and it's not the same, or they don't view it the same as that proper and traditional elite culture. So what are some of these types of popular culture that we see in the 1800s that are arising? Well, as we said before, newspapers. There had been different types of newspapers, but they were often really geared towards certain populations such as merchants and the like. But we see newspapers, general news and entertainment with gossip and crime reports and scandal and all these different types of things, and these really become popular, and they're still popular to today. We read in the chapter in Cullen about those, you know, all the different types and the different ways in which they tried to sell papers. dime novels, we'll see, or we'll kind of address throughout this, these were essentially magazines with lots of short stories or an entire, or a novel or a novella throughout it. And these were periodicals that were released, and again, they were highly popular. Many people read them, and many authors got their early start in them. Charles Dickens, who we all know and is a pretty famous writer, he first got started writing in what are dime novels, or what in England referred to as penny dreadfuls. Traveling variety shows. This is what we'll talk about later on in the semester or the next module, which is minstrel shows, right? And or in particular, blackface minstrel shows. These were very popular shows that were seen throughout the country. Photography. And it's very fascinating to look at early photography, the rise of photography, in contrast to what's going on in the art world. Because as photography becomes more available to the common person, art takes this very interesting turn and starts to be more and more abstract. For a very long time, the goal of art was to represent the real. But when we get photography and you can capture the quote-unquote real, whatever that means, all of a sudden, art takes this detour into the abstract, and we get more and more abstract works that, for the common person, are hard to understand. A person understands a photograph, but to understand some of the more abstract pieces of art of the late 19th and throughout the 20th century is much harder. We also see the rise of college and national sports. We certainly, sports have been around in different capacities, for hundreds of probably thousands of years, certainly thousands of years if we think about the Olympics, but we start to see kind of leagues develop, such as baseball leagues. We start to see college leagues develop, and these start to become elements of pride and representation for different regions. We also see the rise of dance halls, and we move from, the traditional dance environment and proper dance to dance halls where there's wilder music or more popular music, and both women and men are at these dance halls on their own, right? Because we're in these urban settings, people are going to these dance halls just like the clubs today, and they're engaging in all sorts of interactions, both sexual and non-sexual, but the dance halls become this other piece of popular culture. When we get into the early 1900s, we see the rise of music, and what I mean by that is captured music. We see the rise of the CD. We see the rise of the phonograph and the record, right? And what does that mean when you can capture music? Previously, if you wanted music, you needed people and instruments. Now we're getting to a point when you have music captured, and how does that change our relationship to music? We see the rise of comics, first as comic strips in newspapers, and then eventually comic books. And we see the rise of film, and we'll certainly take a look at The Birth of a Nation later in the semester, but the rise of film, and so what does it mean when you can capture moving reality, and is that really reality? Another question we'll grapple with this semester. Radio, so again, we have sound coming into the household, and that can be live sound or pre-recorded sound, but you have that coming into the household or coming into different places, and you can enjoy things. You can have, these radio waves entering your home. And of course, television, which is that further rendering of radio, now both sound and image, captured reality beamed right into your house. And so what does that mean? How does that change our nature of reality? How does that make us, in some ways, more in touch with the world around us? A lot of people talk about looking at these things, particularly film and TV, as checking out of reality. But just like a good novel makes us connect with other people, good television, good movies make us connect with other people. All right, that's all for this mini lecture. Thank you for listening, and see you online.